Well, hello again, friends, and thank you one more time for hanging out with us here at CRC. We love you, and we appreciate you hanging there with us through all the things that are going on in the world today. And we have the privilege this morning, and where I am, but where you are, it might be nighttime, but this morning, to introduce a new series to you. We're going to start working our way through the power-packed little epistle of Paul's letter to the church at Philippi, or Philippi, as some people say it. And we had this plan, in all honesty and transparency, we had this plan back in December of 2019 that in June of 2020, we would work our way as a congregation through the epistle to the Philippians. And we just figured it would be a wonderful time to kind of reset our contentment, reset our joy, because the epistle, although written from prison by the Apostle Paul, along with a few others written from prison, but the epistle is so focused on rejoicing regardless of circumstances. And so here we are in June of 2020, and it's hard to imagine a better book of the Bible to be working our way through. There probably are a couple, but I'll tell you, this has to be in the top five, right? And so we're going to spend some time in Philippians through the month of June, probably taking a break or adding a message on Father's Day to make sure that we do right by our dads. But I want you to grab your Bibles and turn with me to the first chapter of the book of Philippians. You can find it right after Paul's letter to the church at Ephesus. And I'd like to talk to you from the subject, Restored to Contentment and Joy, Part 1, To Live is Christ. To live is Christ. And so this is kind of getting back to our roots. This is what we normally do. We normally spend our time working through large sections of Scripture at once. And although this will be kind of a broad brush through Philippians, we don't have time to really parse it. But I think you'll, if you hang in there with us for these 4 weeks, I think you'll get the point. And by the time we're done, I hope that your contentment level, in other words, your ability to rest in the sovereignty of God, regardless of what's going on around you, and your joy level, i.e. your focus on Him, because how many of you can wave at me, you know, out there in YouTube land, that if you focus on circumstances long enough, you'll definitely lose your joy. But if you focus on Jesus long enough, it'll come back to you. Say amen, somebody. I think I heard a few amens rumbling out there. And so let's go to Philippians chapter 1. I'll read the first two verses, just Paul's introduction, and then I'll give you a little background on what this letter is about and so forth, and kind of work through that a little bit. And then there are a few verses, again, we can't go through them all, but there are a few verses that I think will hopefully be a blessing to you today and cause you to declare, like the Apostle Paul, for to me to live is Christ and to die is gain. Philippians chapter 1, verses 1 and 2, Paul and Timotheus, the servants of Jesus Christ, to all the saints in Christ Jesus, which are at Philippi or Philippi. I think I'm just going to say Philippi because that's the way I'm used to saying it. With the bishops and deacons, grace be unto you and peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. Father, thank you for the privilege to spend some time in the holy text. Thank you, Lord, that you sovereignly, you know, made a plan for us that we'd have this opportunity in the month of June here in 2020, a very pivotal year in our nation, to focus on this theme of contentment in you and joy in you. Indeed, this theme of becoming more Christ-like and rejoicing in that transformation. Father, I pray in Jesus' name that this message would be a blessing to those who hear it. And I pray you guard your servant, Lord, from error. We're just men, and we desperately need you so that your truth would be declared. We love you with all of our hearts and give you praise in Jesus' name. And again, the viewer said, amen. All right. So before I get going, you know, it's really an interesting time that we're in right now. And I have written in my notes, are we tired of the word unprecedented yet? Or what about challenging times, quote unquote? We are in both of those, I believe. And as we minister this word here today, we're facing what we hope is the tail end of a global pandemic. You know, numbers seem to be trending down in COVID-19, and bless the Lord for that. And we're praying that that is coming to a close here reasonably soon. But we're also facing national and international protests because of the death of Mr. George Floyd in Minnesota. In some cases, it went beyond protests, and we've had a chance to sadly see that. We're facing global economic challenges. And in recent weeks, we've seen swarms of locusts, right, in India and Africa. And I believe last week there was an earthquake in California. I believe there was an earthquake. And so, you know, I have jotted in my notes, you just have mercy, Lord. You know, we are really in some interesting days. But how many of you can wave at me through the miracle of technology and say that Jesus is still Lord and Lord of all? Can you wave at me and make that declaration? And the more craziness that goes on around us, and even some of the more difficult things that goes on around us, I am committed and absolutely assured of the fact that Jesus Christ is Lord and He's our answer. And this is what I love about Philippians. It is so focused on our Lord. It is written from a place of injustice. It's written from, because Paul was in prison for wrongs that he didn't commit, right? He was doing good and godly things. It's written from a place of, here are my circumstances, but nevertheless. And that's kind of the attitude that you see in the apostle. And it's kind of the attitude you're given to him, of course, in the Spirit of God. And that's kind of the attitude that I hope to try to cultivate in you and in myself over these next few weeks. And so, not only do we have external things going on in our nation, but we have some internal things going on, as in the heart. We have serious theological and moral issues happening around us. Connected to many of our ills, in my opinion, is the widespread rejection of the Word of God and a biblical worldview, and the Word of God as sufficient regardless of what's going on around us. So again, have mercy, Lord. And as we begin to work our way through Paul's letter to the church at Philippi, where non-circumstantial joy and contentment are some key themes, I really, really do pray that it's a blessing to you. Now, just to try to do due diligence as an exegete, just know that this epistle was written again by the Apostle Paul between 60 and 62 AD, somewhere. That's pretty rough, but yeah, that's probably, you know, pretty good ballpark there. So I've seen some theologians zero in on 61 AD and so forth, but somewhere in that range from Rome. Philippi was a Roman province in the area of Macedonia, which is modern day northern Greece. Paul was imprisoned when he wrote to Philippi, also writing Ephesians and Colossians and Philemon somewhere in the same time frame, the so-called prison epistles. Philippi gets its name from Philip II, father of Alexander the Great, who conquered the region in 4th century BC. It was the first church that Paul planted in Europe during his second missionary journey. And you can read all about Paul's trials and tribulations in Philippi in Acts chapter 16. We might summarize that here. As a matter of fact, let's go ahead and do that now. John MacArthur has a really good summary on this, and so I got some of this from him. What a great teacher he is. And he says, the church at Philippi, the first one founded by Paul in Europe, dates from the apostles, again, second missionary journey. Philippi evidently had a very small Jewish population because there were not enough men to form a synagogue, and the requirement was for 10 Jewish men who were heads of a household. Some devout women met outside the city at a place of prayer. You can read about that in Acts chapter 16, verse 13, alongside the Gangites River. Paul preached the gospel to them, and Lydia, a wealthy merchant dealing in expensive purple dyed goods, Acts chapter 16, verse 14, became a believer. It is likely that the Philippian church initially met in her spacious home. Satanic opposition to the new church immediately arose in the person of a demon-possessed, fortune-telling slave girl, Acts chapter 16, verses 16 through 17, not wanting to even be agreeable at all to the testimony from such an evil source. Paul cast the demon out of her in Acts 16 and 18. The apostles' act enraged the girl's masters, who could no longer sell her services as a fortune teller. They hauled Paul and Silas. Some of y'all are starting to remember this now, because when I grew up, I heard a lot of sermons on Paul and Silas, right? And so Paul and Silas, they hauled them before the city's magistrates and inflamed the civic pride of the Philippians by claiming the two preachers were a threat to Roman customs. As a result, Paul and Silas were beaten and they were in prison. The two preachers were miraculously released from prison that night by an earthquake, which unnerved the jailer and opened his heart. and that all of his household would then hear the gospel and receive the gospel. The next day, the magistrates, panicking when they learned that they had illegally beaten and imprisoned two Roman citizens, begged Paul and Silas to leave Philippi. Paul apparently visited Philippi twice, doing his third missionary journey, once at the beginning, you read about that over in 2 Corinthians chapter 8, and again at the end, Acts chapter 20 and verse 6. About 4 or 5 years after his last visit to Philippi while a prisoner in Rome, Paul received a delegation from the Philippian church. The Philippians had generously supported Paul in the past and had also contributed abundantly for the needs at Jerusalem. Now, hearing of Paul's imprisonment, they sent another contribution to him. We'll read about that over in Philippians chapter 4, verse 10. And along with it, Epaphroditus to minister to Paul's needs. Unfortunately, Epaphroditus suffered a near fatal illness. Read about that in Philippians 2. While either en route to Rome or after he arrived, and accordingly, Paul decided to send Epaphroditus back to Philippi and wrote this letter that we're about to go through to the Philippians when he sent back Epaphroditus. So that's just a little bit of history of how Paul came to found this church and some of his trials and tribulations there. And by way of themes, the focus of this letter, it seems to be twofold. Number one, becoming more like Christ, a major theme in the letter. And number two, walking in contentment and joy despite present circumstances. Again, writing this magnificent epistle from prison. Again, MacArthur says the major theme of pursuing Christ-likeness and the most defining element of spiritual growth and the one passion of Paul in his own life is presented throughout the book of Philippians. William MacDonald said, it is truly the epistle of joy. Oh, do we need that right now? It is truly the epistle of joy. Forms of the word joy and rejoice occurring over 12 times in its 4 chapters. He says Paul knew how to rejoice in good times or in hard times. And quite frankly, I've always found this epistle and this entire narrative concerning Philippi amazing. Paul almost immediately encountered spiritual warfare when he got to Philippi. And then he was arrested after having to deal with a demon. And then he was beaten and then he was thrown in jail. And yet he loved this city anyway. And every time I read it, I think, man, what if we could attain to a more God-centered perspective on what it means to suffer for the kingdom of God? And what if we could love people anyway, what if we can go ahead on and deal with what we need to deal with and bless the people of God anyway? Having an eternal perspective on suffering and trial will jump out at you in this very first chapter. And I pray that that is a blessing to you. If it was us, though, and I was trying to plant a church somewhere and as soon as I got there, I ran into a person possessed with a demon, I might have to figure out another place to plant a church, but not the Apostle Paul, right? And that's not what the kingdom of God does. We know that we're fighting against principalities and powers, and by the grace of God, they get dealt with in the name of Jesus and the kingdom goes forward. So let's jump in. That was a little background. Let's jump into Philippians chapter 1. I have 10 points. And so I'll try to get through them quickly, but 10 points of contentment and joy from Philippians chapter 1. Here's the first one. And then I'll read the verses where they come from. Okay, here's the first one. Contentment and joy from Philippians chapter 1. Number one, our fellowship, like their fellowship, is in the gospel. Listen to Paul after the introductory statements in verses 1 and 2. In verse 3, he says, I thank my God upon every remembrance of you, always in every prayer of mine for you all, making requests with joy. Listen to verse 5. He says, for your fellowship in the gospel from the first day until now. Your fellowship in the gospel from the first day until now. In other words, this church, listen carefully, because this is powerful in our day. This church derived its unity from the gospel of Jesus Christ. The word for fellowship here in the original Greek, that hopefully that means something to you, but we'll go over it again. But the word for fellowship here in the original Greek, you may have heard it before used in church circles. It's koinonia, and it means participation. It means partnership. It means benefaction. It means community, and it suggests a closeness and a covenant based on the finished work of the Lord Jesus. It suggests a unity that God uses for his own purposes. Now, what does this have to do with contentment and joy? Well, beloved, right now there's so much disunity, even in the church. Satan is just doing a wonderful job of dividing the body of Christ. But what if we laser-like focused on the cross again and came together as a body, regardless of how we looked, right? Came together as one body in Jesus Christ, focused on his finished work, and the love and the communion and the fellowship that flowed from the body of Christ produced joy and blessing everywhere that we went. This is the koinonia that we've been trying to maintain in our own local church, and prayerfully that we need in the body of Christ in general. The word is famously used in Acts chapter 2, verse 42, and they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and koinonia and fellowship and breaking of bread and prayers. And look at what broke out based on their fellowship or their unity in the gospel. You might recall from Acts chapter 2, holy fear broke out, unity broke out, common provision broke out, gladness, praise, favor, and folk got saved. Folk were delivered. Everyone's trying to get back to that Acts 2 church, but they were unified around the gospel. They were unified that Jesus came, that Jesus suffered, that Jesus bled, that Jesus died, and the manifest, the outworking of such unity was so powerful that the church grew and expanded in unbelievable God honoring ways. Beloved, what unites all Christians? Where does our true joy and contentment come from? Why did Paul thank God upon every remembrance of the church at Philippi? And why did he pray for them? And why did he pray continually for their joy, for their fellowship in the gospel from the first day until now? What unites believers? Christ. That Jesus Christ is the Son of God and God the Son. That he came to pay the penalty for our sins by his own broken body and by his own shed blood. The apostle thanked God and rejoiced because of their unity in Christ. Church, our fellowship, first and foremost, is in the gospel. Now, later on in this epistle, Paul will advocate for more fellowship around all the other things, too. But first and foremost and foundationally, our fellowship is in the gospel. And that fellowship, that connection to Jesus, that wonderful anointed kind of spirit-born communion that should happen in the hearts of every believer does produce contentment in us. It should produce peace in us. It should produce joy in us that we're not alone in this, that there are believers who believe the exact same thing that you do, and they're of all colors, and they're all shades, and they're all ages, and they're all places in the world, and there are people who believe in the shed blood and broken body of Jesus in Asia and in Africa and in China. And there, down through the ages, there are people who have read the same words out of the same text, and so that you know, hey, you're not by yourself. You're not alone, right? So there's a peace that comes from that. There's a joy that comes from that. Therefore, be encouraged, because at the cross, you can forgive your brother. At the cross, you can find strength to persevere. At the cross, you can find the power to love your enemies. The Apostle Paul said, I thank God for you. I thank God for your fellowship in the gospel from the first day until now. And he'll go on to encourage them to fight to maintain that unity, but it was there in Philippi. And so in any situation, you can go to the cross together. Now is the time for a word like this, where the church of God needs to unite around the cross of Jesus, around the shed blood of Jesus Christ, around the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. And if I sound like a broken record, hold on, because I'm going to keep saying it. If there was ever a day that the gospel needs to be preached and the gospel needs to be unified around, it's now. And so you can have this joy of Christian sisterhood and Christian brotherhood. And the gospel, by the way, is so powerful, it can obliterate everything else. It could tear down walls of separation and make two one. That's the power of the gospel. And the apostle made no bones about it. He said, I am grateful for this. I am grateful for your fellowship around the gospel from the first day until now. And he rejoiced because of it. May we be able to do the same thing. So that was the first point there. Just our fellowship like theirs is in the gospel. Oh, beloved, let our fellowship be in the gospel. Here's the second point from verse number 6, where the apostle says, being confident of this very thing, that he which begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. The second point is simply this: God will finish the work in us too. I believe that. I believe that God started a work in you and I as believers, and I believe he'll finish that work just like the apostle believed that God would finish the work among the saints in Philippi. In the flow of thought, in the text, Paul says that because of their unity in Christ, right, because of their unity in the gospel, that he was confident that the God who started the work in them would complete it until the day of Jesus Christ. And again, I like to think that we can hold this verse in our lives as well. Why? Well, because when the Lord saved us, the work began. Wave at me if you know that's true. When the Lord saved you and I, a work began in us, a sovereign work of God began in us. And if we stay committed to our Lord, and if we stay committed to the gospel, then the same God who saved us is the same God who will sustain us and the same God who will complete the work in us. In other words, there ought to be some joy and some contentment in the fact that God's not done with us yet. Hallelujah, he's not. Since he alone is the author of the work, he alone is the finisher of the work. And that should bring a verse to mind for some of you, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who, for the joy that was set before him, endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. He is our author. He started it. He is our finisher. He'll complete it. And so that brings me a little joy, because when things are crazy, I don't know if I'm going to be able to do the things that God has called me to do. When I'm struggling within myself, I'm not completely sure. Lord, am I going to be able to keep preaching? Am I going to be able to help people? Lord, can I rise to the occasion and be present and be filled with your spirit and used for a day and a time such as this? Well, here's the word. He started the work in you, and he'll finish the work in you into the day of Jesus Christ. And for us, it meant the same as them, right? Until we go home to be with him, until he comes back again, one or the other. But he started the work and he'll finish the work. Therefore, be encouraged, for we are still his workmanship, just like Philippi was, just like Ephesus was. We too, through the gospel, big there, through the gospel, we are his workmanship as well, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before the world, right? Before ordained, rather, that we should walk in them. So God has literally ordained that we should walk in good works. He started them, he'll finish them. Well, again, that ought to produce, hopefully, a little bit of joy in you that he's not done with you yet. Hallelujah. And maybe even a little contentment, too. Maybe you've been a little anxious about some things, but he's the sustainer. He's the author. He's the finisher. It's not by your might or your power, but it's always going to be by his spirit. And so if you're still alive, God is still working. No situation is unrecoverable in Jesus Christ. In him, all things are possible. And so point one was our fellowship like theirs should be in the gospel. That's a joyful thing. Point two, just like God wasn't done with them, he's not done with us either. Hopefully that blesses you. Point three, from verse 9, where the apostle says, and this I pray, that your love may abound yet more and more in knowledge and in all judgment. I have written here very simply, number three, let us let our love and knowledge abound more and more. Since we have the opportunity for unity in Christ, again, in the flow of thought, and since we have the hope that our Lord will hold us and use us until the day of Jesus Christ, we might as well go head on and love each other deeply and continue to learn and grow in Jesus. Please know that the kind of love that the apostle is talking about here is rooted in our growing knowledge and in our growing discernment. Some versions say they're using that word in verse 9. Instead of judgment, it says discernment. So in our growing knowledge and our growing discernment. Now, here's something that I've noticed not necessarily in our church, but every once in a while around the edges. Here's something that I've noticed, that when people grow, when the people grow in knowledge, their love goes cold. And that's not what the Bible says. I've seen people literally grow their way out of relationships. And the apostle here seems to be saying the opposite. I mean, we say stuff like that. Sometimes you just outgrow people. All right, well, here's the Bible. Let's let our love and knowledge abound more and more. Paul was talking about unity and the church staying together. And he was saying the more they grew in the knowledge of God and the more they grew in judgment or their ability to discern the things of God, the more they would stay unified. How about that? That's different, isn't it? Praise God. Hallelujah. Okay, but sadly, our experiences are exactly the opposite. Most of the time, our love grows cold the more we, quote unquote, learn. How tragic, because it ought to be the opposite. You know, there's a couple of trajectories out there that I've talked about before. You know, there's one school of thought where people learn the Bible and read the Bible and supposedly grow in the Bible. And they get looser, they get wider, they get broader. And then there's another stream of thought or another group of folk where the more they learn and grow and study the Bible, then they, you're not going to like this word, but it's a Bible word, but they get tighter, right? They get narrower. They start to hone in and on the gospel and hone in on the things. And so there's one group that they read and the Bible seems to say, do whatever you want. And there's another group that they read and grow and the Bible says the way is narrow. Which road are you on? Well, the Apostle Paul here, I believe, is making the case for the latter, and they're boresighting in on the gospel. And as we go through the epistle, you'll see what I'm talking about. But their unity was supposed to actually grow in that. Now, that requires a little effort, and that requires the Spirit of God. But I believe it's a joyful thing to grow in unity, to grow in love, and therefore let us grow intentionally. Let's keep reading. Let's keep reaching out. Let's keep inviting. Let's keep spending time with one another in the scriptures. Growing love and growing in truth needs maintenance. It's not going to just happen. You got to go for it. The apostle said, and this I pray that your love will abound. So your love's going up, even as your knowledge and your discernment is going up. Those two things are, you know, they seem to be clashing in the culture, but not in the Bible. Those two things are supposed to be happening at the same time, and they're supposed to produce unity. They're supposed to produce contentment, peace, and joy. All right? So let's keep growing. That's the lesson here. Let's keep growing. Let's keep growing in the things of God. Okay. Point four. Let us adopt a gospel perspective about trials. Now, again, I'm just walking through this. This isn't, I'm not trying to be too deep with it, but look at verse 12 with me in Philippians chapter 1. But I would ye should understand, brethren, that the things which happened to me, again, writing from prison, that the things which happened unto me have fallen out rather unto the furtherance of the gospel. I love this. For the furtherance of the gospel. Paul said, hey, I'm locked up, but you know what? It's going to be a blessing. God's going to turn this thing. He's going to use this, right? What a perspective. Number four, let us adopt a gospel perspective about trials. Now, here was the Apostle Paul, innocent because he's doing the things that God has asked him to do. Nevertheless, locked up in a prison in Rome, right? Having done nothing wrong. And he's saying, you know what? It's good. Because God's going to, whatever, he's so sovereign, he's so great, he's so powerful, that he's going to use my imprisonment to save people. What? I mean, I would be on the phone with my lawyer, man. I'm trying to get somebody to bail me out of this jank, right? But Paul is saying the exact opposite. Paul from prison understood the sovereignty of God. He understood and knew God's purpose for him was to preach the gospel to the Gentiles, but he also knew by virtue of that purpose that God had promised him some suffering. You might recall it in Acts chapter 9. But the Lord said unto him, go thy way, for he is a chosen vessel unto me to bear my name before the Gentiles and kings and the children of Israel. For I will show him, listen, how great things he must suffer for my name's sake. The Lord Jesus, in beginning to activate Paul's ministry, sent a message to Paul saying, hey, you know what? You're going to suffer for me. I chose you. You are chosen. How many of y'all want to be chosen? Okay. Amen. You are chosen, but I'm going to show you who I want you to speak to and how much you're going to have to suffer for that. That was the Lord's message to Paul. How's that for a marketing strategy? Come to our church. It's time to suffer. Bless God. Right? That's not the way we do it, right? And that's the opposite of the way we do it. But Paul's gospel-centered kind of eternal perspective on this whole idea of trials and suffering is something that I think we should strive to take on board under the unction of the Holy Spirit. Jesus made it very clear. He said, blessed are ye when men shall revile you and persecute you and shall say all manner of evil against you falsely for my sake. He said, rejoice and be exceedingly glad, for great is your reward where? In heaven. If you might recall it, this is Matthew chapter 5, verses 11 and 12. For so persecuted they the prophets which were before you. And this is the perspective that we need to balance out our Western pursuit of comfort and our individual sense of entitlement. This is the truth, beloved. And I believe it'll produce some contentment in you if you can come out of the Western mindset for just a moment. Sometimes God calls his saints to suffer for his name and to suffer for the gospel. Period. I mean, and sometimes that's the call. And so sometimes it's not the devil, or maybe the devil is being utilized, but sometimes it's the call of God for you to take that stand, right? For you to say that thing, for you to center all of it in the gospel, for you to love enough to be truthful, and it doesn't work out the way our human mind might want it to, and God is sitting in heaven going, well done, great job. Paul was in prison talking about all this is going to work out for the furtherance of the gospel. Amen, somebody. Okay. Therefore, be encouraged, because if you are a believer and you are striving for holiness and you are ministering the gospel of Christ in love, the things which are happening to you will work out towards the furtherance of the gospel. In other words, if you're tracking along with our Lord, and remember, a servant is not greater than his master, but if you're tracking with Jesus, right, if you got the cross on your back and you're saying, hey, this life is for Christ, and he's going a little deeper in here, so we're just starting the epistle. We're still kind of in an introduction, right? But if you're tracking with Jesus, you are going to run into some conflicts because of your faith and because of the truth that you represent. And those things, believe it or not, beloved, are ordained of God. If your heart is right and you're walking with the Lord and you encounter an imprisoned type situation, some conflict type situation, a persecution type situation, and you stand in there, it can turn out for the furtherance of the gospel. And if we're going to suffer, that's the kind of suffering we want. We don't want suffering because of our individual iniquity and our rebellion and our disobedience to the word. That's not what we want. If we got to suffer, we want the kind of suffering that comes from standing firm on truth with love pouring out of our hearts, right? And saying, here's what thus saith the Lord of hosts. And so be encouraged, because if that's where you are, then you never know how God might use your present circumstances to push forward the message of the kingdom. Point five from verse 20. Again, a broad brush. Don't have time to, you know, it would take a year to go through Philippians, right, if we did it, you know, in the normal kind of exegetical way. But we're just kind of grabbing the pieces for encouragement and joy out of Philippians here in June of 2020. Point five, let us magnify Christ and not be ashamed. Look at verse 20. According to my earnest expectation and my hope, that in nothing I shall be ashamed, but that with all boldness, as always, so now also Christ shall be magnified in my body, whether it be by life or by death. So now we're going in. He's starting to go in a little bit. All right, here's me and Timothy. You know, hey, guys, how you doing? Hope you're good. Praying for you. Y'all have been unified in the gospel from the first day until now. Maintain that unity. It's what's going to keep you. It's what's going to hold you. It's what's going to bless you. Don't let that unity go. And oh, by the way, the God who started the work is the God who will finish the work. And while you, since you're working and since you're unified, go ahead on and grow in love and let that love grow more and more. Also grow in knowledge now. Keep studying, keep doing these things. All these things are going to bless you. Now, but understand, I'm writing to you by way of example. Remember, imitate me as I imitate Christ. I'm in prison for my faith. So you might mess around and need that unity in the gospel. You might mess around and need these understandings, because the same thing happened to me might happen to you. Therefore, don't be ashamed of it all. God is going to turn the situation to the point where the gospel will be furthered because of my chains. And then we find ourselves now in verse 20. So it's warming up. I hope you can see it. It's warming up. There's some introduction, right? There's some encouragement, generally speaking, to the church about unity and so forth. And now I said, now listen, according to my earnest expectation and my hope that in nothing I shall be ashamed, but that with all boldness as always, so now also Christ will be magnified in my body, whether it be by life or death. Here's the point. Let us adopt a similar mindset. Let us magnify Christ, whether it be by our living or our dying, and let us not be ashamed. Hallelujah. I feel that with myself. I needed that with myself. Let us not be ashamed. As we always say, we're going somewhere with this, right? Our living and our dying, our trials and our good times, if it is in the name of Jesus, we're going somewhere with this. In our prayer times as a church, we've been praying through 1 Peter chapter 3, and we've learned that in all these things, there's an inheritance that's being kept for us that's incorruptible and undefiled and cannot be spoiled, that's kept in heaven for us. Therefore, be ye holy as I am holy. We're going somewhere with this. Hallelujah. We're going somewhere with this. So there's no need to be ashamed, because there's a God that sent his son to die for our sin. There's no need to be ashamed. So if you're going to live, then go ahead and live in Jesus. But if you got to die, then go ahead on and die in Jesus. Hallelujah. And that's the mindset that we need right now, where everybody's afraid to speak and everybody's afraid of this and everybody's afraid of that, and you're canceled and you're over. Well, let it be so in the name of Jesus. But here's the declaration. He is Lord and he is Lord of all. There's one name under heaven whereby men must be saved, and that is the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. There's one mediator between God and man, and that is the man Jesus Christ. Hallelujah, Christian. Hallelujah. So put your armor on and don't be ashamed. Don't back up now. Don't back up now. Don't go back now. And this is the uncomfortable truth. We all like to be seen in a positive light. Suffering is embarrassing. Going backwards activates our pride. But Paul wasn't ashamed. His title was already gone, his old title anyway. And his wealth was already gone. Oh, by the way, apostle has all this prestige now, but back then it meant you were hunted, okay? And so his title was gone, his wealth was gone, his prestige had been all swallowed up in the Lord Jesus Christ. And the only thing that mattered to him at this point was honoring Christ in his living and in necessary his dying. Therefore, let us follow the apostle as he followed Christ with the same heart, with the same attitude. And here's the truth, beloved. A lot of our disappointment, dis-ease, all the way over into depression, really, is not because Jesus is the Lord, because he is. It's because of circumstances. It's because of stuff happening around you, stuff happening to you, how you feel about the stuff happening around you or the stuff happening to you. What a transformative mindset. If in the Holy Ghost, we can say, I'm not ashamed of Jesus Christ, whether by my living or whether by my dying. He's the very air that I breathe. And so if he decrees good things for me, bless his name. And if he decrees some difficult things for me, bless his name. Because in all things, bless his name. Where am I getting this from? This is Paul's mindset writing from prison. This was the mindset that caused the apostles to walk in so much power and give their lives for Jesus. This is the mindset that enabled the early church meeting in underground caverns called catacombs and in different places to be hunted throughout the early Roman Empire of this time period, to be hunted down like criminals because they loved Jesus Christ, to be misaligned and misconstrued and misunderstood. And yet the church exploded. Beloved, Jesus calls all of us to carry our cross for him and to not be ashamed of that cross. Oh, it's that day. It's needed right now. To speak the words of God right now might seem or be off-putting to some, but it is precisely what we need to do. He's not done. Verse 21, for to me to live is Christ and to die is gain. In our church, this is the Jesus is enough scripture. This is the one that inspired the mindset of Jesus being enough for us, 10, 12 years ago now. But to live is Christ and to die is gain. That gives me such peace. Every time I don't have it all the time, but I can get a little bit of it. Contentment just fills my heart. To live is Christ, to die is gain. You're not worried about a television set. You're not worried about a job thing. You in that moment where you can grab that verse, it all kind of falls away and make it all the worldliness kind of crashes. And what's really important makes total sense and joy fills your heart. To live is Christ. So in my living, it's Christ. What would the Lord have me do? What would the Lord want me to say? How would the Lord want me to be a blessing? What would the Lord want me to do in this situation? To die is gain. Even if it costs me before a physical death, even if it costs me prestige, name, persecution, wealth, title, honor, all the way into physical death, it's gain. The Christian cannot lose. Don't think worldly, think spiritually with me. The Christian, okay, cannot lose. For living is Christ, that's victory. Dying is gain, that's victory. Hallelujah, right? Hallelujah to the Lamb of God. Hallelujah. That's the mindset, beloved. That's where contentment is. Well, if I can just upgrade my Xbox, I'd be, no, you won't. You won't be content because there will be one that come out next year. That's not going to do it. Well, if things would just get situated in Washington, D.C., I'd be content. They're never going to get situated, number one, okay? And number two, there's always going to be something to pick at, no matter who's up there, all right? So that's always been the case. Just look at history, okay? So that's not going to fix it either. Well, you know what? If my husband or my wife would just get right, okay, but they're sinful. And they'll have seasons of getting right, but eventually they'll make mistakes. And so if they're acting just right is where you derive your joy from, you're going to struggle all the time. Just like if someone had was completely depending on you and your behavior for their joy, they would be disappointed too, right? To live is Christ, to die is gain. This is the Christian life in one verse. All of our living is in Jesus. It's for him, through him, and about him. It is to honor him and glorify him at all costs. If such a life costs us our very lives, then bless the Lord, for to die is gain. From the NLT, it says, but if I live, I can do more fruitful work for Christ, he goes on to say in verse 22. So I really don't know which is better. Listen to Paul. This is not the way we think. So I really don't know which is better. I'm torn between two desires. I long to go be with Christ. First of all, who longs to go be with Christ? Everybody knows they need to say that. But come on now. Come on. Maybe some of you. I long to go be with Christ, which would be far better for me. But for your sakes, says the apostle, it is better that I continue to live. Knowing this, I am convinced that I will remain alive so I can continue to help all of you grow and experience the joy of your faith. Paul was saying, I'm ready to go home and be with the Lord right now. His desire literally was to die and go live with Jesus. But it's better, he says, for y'all. So I'm torn between the two. Most of us ain't torn. We're trying to live now, right? But there's something in the heart of the apostle here given to us in the inspired text that is beneficial for our contentment and joy. If you died today, does it produce any contentment in you, any joy in you that you'd go be with Jesus? That the worst thing that could happen to you is actually the best thing that could happen to you. For to live is Christ and to die is gain. And this is where that ridiculous, wonderful joy comes from in believers when we're thinking straight, right? This is where it comes from. This is how we can look at out of control situations and go, let's move in there. Let's do what we need to do to try to make sure that that doesn't happen again. But blessed be the name of the Lord. Right. This is how you deal with tragedy and not lose your mind because it's not over. It's just beginning. It's right here. Therefore, be encouraged. Jesus is enough. He's more than enough. He's got you in life. He's got you in death. You have victory either way if you belong to him. If you don't belong to him, repent and believe right now, beloved. Repent and believe right now. Turn from sin, turn from iniquity, and turn to the only one who can save you, the Lord Jesus Christ. Believe the gospel. Repent of your sins and believe in the gospel. That right now, Again, if I sound like a broken record, I can't even help myself right now, because the gospel is being turned into all these other things. But the gospel is about forgiveness from sin. It is about being able to stand before a holy God one day and not experience his wrath because your sins have been washed away by the suffering of his son. That's the gospel. That'll always be the gospel. And Lord, forgive us if we ever try to preach another gospel other than that. Now, the outshoots of that ought to be acts of service and works and taking care of the oppressed and all the works of righteousness. But those are manifestations of the gospel. That's what gospel people do. We go love on folk and we preach the word of the living God. So if you've not experienced the grace, the saving grace in Jesus Christ, and if right now you would face a holy God and experience his wrath because you're still carrying your sins around, then repent and believe in him in the name of Jesus Christ. That was point six. To live as Christ, to die as gain. To, you know, that is more that can be said there, but to catch that is to have true, lasting peace, joy, and contentment, such that the devil honestly can't take it. It doesn't mean your heart won't get broken. It doesn't mean you won't have times of sadness. But it does mean that you can't stay there, because you're somehow in the sovereignty of God, all these things will turn out in such a way that he'll be honored and glorified in your life because you belong to him. So even times of sadness can be used to bring you closer to Jesus. It's a perspective. It's a mindset that flows from the cross. OK. Number seven, from verse 27, the first part of verse 27. Let us live lives worthy of this gospel that we've been talking about. Verse 27 says, the first part says, only let your conversation be as it becometh the gospel of Christ, that whether I come and see you or else be absent, I may hear of your affairs, that ye stand fast in one spirit and striving together for the faith of the gospel. So the first part there is focused on the life, or the conversation in King James, the life. Let us live lives then worthy of this gospel. That's what Paul was essentially saying. The ESV says, only let your manner of life be worthy of the gospel of Christ. Paul was saying, so if life is truly about the Lord in your hearts, your lives will start to match. If we are truly overwhelmed by the immensity of the gospel and the overwhelming nature of the work of Christ on the cross, and this command, although big, begins to make sense to us, right? He's done so much for us who didn't deserve it. How can we not live lives commensurate with what he has done? How can we not order our lives to the glory of Christ? Therefore, be encouraged, beloved, because there are, I keep saying beloved. That's just, I've been reading the Bible a lot, y'all, and that word is stuck in my heart. But be encouraged, friends, right? Be encouraged. The opportunity right now for your life to manifest before the world in a way that shines light is off the charts. It's off the charts. How you handle injustice and oppression, how you deal with uncertainty and physical illness, how you deal with varying perspectives on governmental control, how you manage your family life, how you talk to people right now, and the things that come out of your mouth, are they godly? Do they reflect the character of Jesus? Oh, the need's so great. Need's so great. Listen, I didn't mean to go here, but I'm going. What you say right now matters. How you say it right now matters. Where you're pointing with your life right now matters. Matters. Because when you have a lot of people who are hurt or angry or in a high emotional state, you can come in and speak peace and blessing and the things of God in that situation or not. I urge the former. Okay. So our lives, may our conversation, says the apostle, may it be becoming of the gospel of Christ. Let's do that. Let's realign and reorder everything so that it shows the world we are grateful that Jesus came, suffered, bled, and died for us. Number eight, let us stand firm in unity. The last part of verse 27, he uses these phrases. He says, stand fast in one spirit. This phrase here, with one mind striving together. one spirit, one mind, striving together. In that same verse, Paul intimates again in verse 27 that such living should produce a practical unity. And it makes sense. If our lives then are being formed around the gospel and are in a manner worthy of the gospel, then unity would be a wonderful fruit of that. If we're focused on the Lord and we are dead to ourselves, why? Because to live is Christ, to die is gain. Unity or having one mind or striving together should be something that we can see. Think about this phrase, one mind striving together. One mind striving together. That ought to be the church, is it? That ought to be your home to some degree, is it? Probably not, but are we working towards it? Is it in our prayers that we think that way and behave that way and act that way, unified around the gospel of Jesus Christ? In Christ, I believe it can be, and I believe he desires it of us. So let us set our hearts to prayer and put our feet to work in that direction. Be encouraged to stand in one spirit. There is one body and one spirit, even as ye are called in one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in you all. Amen. So let's stand firm in our unity. But our unity is our fellowship. Our unity is in the gospel and in what thus saith the Lord. Number 9. No, by the way, that's a beautiful thing, because I don't want to get in too much trouble here. But our unity in the gospel, you know, right now, here's an interesting, fun question. Are you a Christian first or are you something else first? Because if you're a Christian first, then you're set up for unity. But if you're something else first before you're a Christian first, probably not so much. Just give that some thought. Number 9, let us choose confidence in Christ instead of fear. Philippians chapter 1, verse 28, and in nothing terrified by your adversaries, which is to them an evident token of perdition, but to you of salvation and that of God. If that sounds a little strange because of the language, here it is from the New Living Translation. Don't be intimidated in any way by your enemies. This will be a sign to them that they are going to be destroyed, but that you are going to be saved even by God himself. Lots of things you can say there, but for today, it doesn't matter if you're in some form of prison like Paul was. And I don't mean necessarily literally iron bars, but some kind of conflict. You don't have to fear your enemies. You can worship God and love them instead. Remember Paul and Silas in the Philippian jail, as I mentioned earlier, when the jailer saw that they hadn't escaped, he was broken. Not only were they not afraid of him, they ministered the gospel to him. And as a result, the whole household was saved. The foundation of such love for their enemy, they spent the night praying. Paul and Silas, you know, trapped in jail. Here come Jesus to pay that bill. He can do the same thing for you. Y'all remember them songs? You know, singing hymns all night to God and being in that place where when the time came, they were able to love their enemies and not fear them. They were able to choose Christ. And as a result, the jailer's house got saved, too. That's the power of the gospel of Jesus Christ. When the jailer ends up getting saved. I wonder what sort of worship-inspired, God-wrought earthquakes, because remember, an earthquake came and freed them. So I wonder what kind of earthquakes we could stir up in our worship and our love for others right now. And I'm not talking about a physical 5.5 in California or whatever it was. I'm talking about an earthquake in our lives where it shakes up for the glory of God, and the jailers in our lives end up getting saved and their households. Hallelujah to God. We have to start thinking biblically. Because, you know, God is still fully capable of performing what looks like a miracle. People are saying for the country to blah, 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 it's going to take a miracle. Yeah, it's going to take Jesus. It's going to take Christ. It's going to take Christians who think and move and act Christianly, right? And I think this example right here in Philippians, both Paul's activity in the church at Philippi and his mindset as it relates to writing these kinds of words while in prison, I think, speaking pretty loudly, and I hope you can hear it. Therefore, be confident in the Lord. Choose faith instead of fear. Okay. And then finally, number 10, may we remember that suffering for Christ is an honor. Listen to verse 29. For unto you it is given in the behalf of Christ, not only to believe on him, but also to suffer for his sake. Again, for clarity from the King James language, listen to the NLT. For you have been given not only the privilege of trusting in Christ, but also the privilege of suffering for him. The privilege of suffering for him. This is one of the chief practical lessons we can learn from the apostles. They had a different view. I'd go as far as to say an eternal view of suffering. Remember what they said after being beaten by order of the religious leaders in Jerusalem in Acts chapter 5? They said, well, Acts 5:40 says, and to him they agreed. And when they had called the apostles and beaten them, they commanded that they should not speak in the name of Jesus and let them go. And they departed from the presence of the council, rejoicing that they were counted worthy to suffer shame for the name. And daily in the temple and in every house, they ceased not to teach and preach Jesus Christ. They were beaten unfairly, counted it an honor to suffer for Jesus, and went right back to work. It's just it's an amazing thing. And this is one of those practical lessons we, as we follow them, as they followed Christ, that we could learn from them. They rejoiced. They counted it an honor. Scripture says rejoicing that they were counted worthy. Paul is saying here, what a privilege it is not just to trust him, but to suffer for him. Therefore, be encouraged in the Lord, friends. There's a lot of suffering right now going on. I pray yours is in the Lord if you're going through it at all. In the sovereignty of God, as long as we are walking hard after Christ, even our suffering, I know this is going to sound crazy, but even our suffering can be cause for rejoicing. It's a way out different way of thinking. It just so happens to be extraordinarily biblical. Our Lord promised us that sometimes things wouldn't go the way we want them to go. He told us in this world that there would be suffering and tribulation and so forth. We live in a fallen world. We're dealing with principalities and powers. Yet the apostles somehow in the Holy Ghost were able to say, wow, that was really hard. We're really in a lot of pain, but bless you, Lord, for the privilege to suffer for thy name. And look at what they did in response. They ceased not to teach and preach Jesus Christ daily in the temple and in every house. Paul's in prison. What's he doing? Writing letters to the magistrate trying to get out? That would have been okay. Would have been no sin in that. But what's he doing? Writing letters to the church saying, rejoice. I want you to have that kind of contentment and joy. And may I be honest? I want that kind of contentment and joy. I don't have it. Something happens to me and I have a serious attitude. I'm such a sinner. But I want this. I want this. I want this in my remaining days on this earth. I want this so badly. Because this is the kind of contentment and peace and joy that the world didn't give and the world can't take away. And I want this so badly, and I hope you do too. When you get this, this literally means that you can rejoice at all times. You can rejoice when times are good. You can rejoice when times aren't. You can say thank you, Jesus, when you get the promotion. You can say thank you, Jesus, when you're let go. You can say thank you, Jesus, when the world seems peaceful. You can say thank you, Jesus, for the opportunities to minister your grace when the world gets chaotic and crazy. You can literally rejoice at all times. Sounds like a psalm, doesn't it? I will bless the Lord at all times, and his praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul shall make her boast in the Lord. The humble shall hear thereof and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. I sought the Lord, and he heard me and delivered me from all my fears. They looked unto him and were lighted, and their faces were not ashamed. This poor man cried, and the Lord heard him and saved him out of all his troubles. The angel of the Lord encampeth round about them that fear him and delivereth them. O taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man that trusteth in him. Beloved, I hope you grabbed hold of those points. I hope that the Lord produces new contentment, fresh joy, wonderful peace in your life as we walk through Philippians together. I pray that you are out there actively helping people, preaching the gospel, loving on the broken, hurting the broken and hurting people. I pray that your table as much as possible is open, your heart is open, your email accounts are open, and that you're ministering grace and peace in the word of God during the times in which we live. And I pray in the name of Jesus, the blessings of this contentment and peace that we're talking about, again, To live is Christ and to die is gain. I pray that blessing over your household today. Father, in Jesus' name, thank you for the honor to just walk through, albeit quickly, this chapter. I don't think I did it justice, but I pray that your people who heard it will be inspired to take another look and to look at the life of this apostle that you anointed for the time that he walked among us and the inspired words that he wrote, words that you gave him, so that we too can declare that we will not be ashamed, but in our living, Lord, and in our dying, you would be honored. To live is Christ, to die is gain. And out of such conviction, out of such joy, and out of such contentment, we would minister your grace, minister your truth, minister your love to those all around us who are hurting. We love you with all of our hearts today and give you praise. In Jesus' name, amen.